Now this video will teach you how to paint a realistic watercolour ivy leaf in a botanical illustration style. They could use your painting to make a special or personal Christmas card for somebody, or if you want to, pop it in a frame and stick it on the wall. But whatever you decide to do, we'll do one thing first, haven't we? Let's get the brushes wet. My name is Paul Hopkinson and I'm a professional watercolour artist. I paint animals, birds and plants in a realistic style and enjoy sharing my knowledge and expertise with other artists out there to learn the joy of watercolours. Now in the description below you find a link where you can download the reference photograph, the outline drawing and of course the colours you need to be able to paint this subject.
Right, ready to make a start? Okay, now the first thing we need to do is get the outline drawing onto the paper. Now I've given you the reference photograph and also the outline drawing for this ivy leaf as well. So you can use whatever method you would normally use to get the drawing onto the surface. Right, colour wise, we're going to be using these colours here today. And we're going to be working with lemon yellow, sap green, hooker's green, Payne's grey, lamp black, burnt sienna, alizarin crimson, burnt umber, and a little bit of white paint as well. Now mine is opaque white, which is a watercolour white. Okay, you can use white gouache if you wish to as well. So it's your choice, whichever one you wish to use. Okay, the colour we're going to mix is this one here first of all, which is hooker's green, lemon yellow and Payne's grey. More to a watery consistency. And to mix these, as I do for all my wildlife paintings which I do for my online school, is going to be the half pans I tend to use all the time. Okay, now make this into a water consistency as I say, and you know when it's watery, so it just runs right down the side of the mixing well very, very quickly, as if it's water from a tap. Okay. Using a size 5 brush, what we're going to do is very lightly wet the ivy leaf first of all. And this will dilute the paint, the mix we just got there. So very lightly wet it first of all. I'll get this painted, I'll zoom in a little bit shortly for you as well. Oh, before we go into that, let's just wet all the ivy leaf actually. Now having a brush with a half decent tip, a very good point on it, is very useful. I mean, this one is by Rosemary & Co, which is a series 93. So it's a very good brush. I use it a lot for just kind of the washes really, more than anything for the wildlife work I do. So just make sure that you put this on probably a couple of times, just to ensure that it stays wetter longer and allow it to soak into the paper that little bit as well. If it's running down the paper like a waterfall, it's too wet, all right? So bear that in mind. Just allow it to soak into that paper a little bit more. Okay, then just apply this colour over the whole ivy leaf. Try and keep within those edges if you can. And to be honest with you, if you don't keep within the edge, it goes slightly over, it's not a problem at all. Every leaf is just about different, isn't it? I mean, they all tend to vary in shape and size, even though they have their, you know, kind of normal kind of shape to a certain degree. I mean, this one's missing a tip off the edge of that side there, which is, you know, which is a little bit extra character to it as well. Then allow it to dry, or you can give it a quick dry with a hairdryer, but if you do that, do it from a distance as well. So usually probably about a foot, 2 feet away, something like that, so it doesn't burn the paper. And when you do anything like that, using the hairdryer, just wave it backward and forward from that distance so he's not kind of stood in one spot for too long. Okay, I'm going to give this a dry, probably bring that down to there, that'll do. So I'm going to give it a dry and then we're going to start adding the darker details over the top.
Right, so we'll start off with sap green and Payne's grey. Now load that brush up, but make sure that you take that little bit of paint off the brush before you make a start, okay? So you want to load it in the paint, roll it as you pull away from the mixing palette, and then lightly tap it just once on some kitchen roll before you go to the main painting. At least by doing it that way around, you find that you've got less paint on the brush and give you a much sharper tip as well. So doing this just with the very tip of the brush, you're going to start to outline the main kind of veins within this leaf, kind of picking out different sections as you go along. So take your time with this, and try and get these little sections as accurate as you can get it, okay? So keep looking at that reference photograph all the way through. So trying to keep these in the right kind of shape and form will then give you sections to work within as you start to add all the details within this painting. I hope you're enjoying this realistic eye relief tutorial so far. I release a new video here on YouTube every single week, so it's worth you subscribing to my channel here so you don't miss any. And if you click that little bell icon down below, you should be notified. Thank you. Now, when you start to add the little details within the painting, now think about doing this again with the very tip of the brush, but do this in like a scumbling technique. So very small squirrels and squiggles, that's what you're looking for to begin with. We can build on these as we go along thereafter, so we've just got to get this basic kind of level of detail on the paper first of all. And as I mentioned, we can gradually start to darken that and add more contrast to that as we go along. And you'll also find the more paint that you've got on the brush, the darker the marks will be. But don't worry too much at this stage trying to get the really dark areas on there. We want to start off fairly light to begin with. This isn't that light, I know, but we want to start off with a lighter hue, because remember, eye relief is a fairly dark green, aren't they? Like an emerald, kind of deep green. So we've got to try and replicate that, but we're going to gradually build up these details I mentioned as we go along. So just get this first foundation detail layer on, and then we can start to kind of fine tune all that and consider the overall shapes. Now you can see what I'm doing with this is trying to outline the different sections we can see. So where you've got these little veins going through the leaf, I'm trying to work on either side of that, but I'll tell you one thing, don't worry too much if you don't get it accurate, because we're using a lifting off technique later on, just by removing the paint off the paper using the very tip of the brush, but we'll go through that later on, okay? So if you don't worry too much about getting these too accurate when you're adding these details on and trying to work on these little sections. Then what we need to do is very lightly soften these details down. And all I simply do is just put my size 00 brush into some water, lightly drag it through some kitchen roll in my hand, and then just very lightly, barely touching the paint, just go over the top of that paint, all the details just put on. Now this will in turn soften those details down just that little bit. You don't want to blend them away, remember, just to kind of soften them a little bit. And that kind of knocks it back and prepares it ready for the next layer of paint to go over the top. So all you need to do from here on, follow the same method for the rest of the leaf, okay? There's nothing different, don't worry about contrast or anything like that. Just get this first foundational detail layer on, and then we can start working on the top of that. Akin it to something like building a house, okay? So when you're putting down the foundations first of all, then you got to build the walls, haven't you? You got to start putting them layers on top of that foundation. And that's how we're going to work in a way by working on this leaf today. Now then, let's add a little bit more Payne's Grey into this mix. I want to kind of create more of a bluer feel to the paint, because this leaf isn't really bright green, is it? There's more like a blue tint to it. So adding just that little bit more Payne's Grey can help it along and just kind of change the flavour, the colour. That was very arty, wasn't it, flavour? But change the colour a little bit and test it as well on some scrap watercolour paper. Because at least that way, if you're testing it on the same paper you're doing the main painting on, as in little scraps, then at least you know the consistency will be about right, you know the colour will be about right. Because we all know that different watercolour papers tend to react in different ways to paint. Now we're starting to think about the curves and the shapes within this, so we've got to look at the different areas we can see within this area. So we've got to think about just looking at the different shapes we can see inside each section of the leaf, basically, to leave gaps in between to allow for lighter and darker sections. Now also note the various shapes that you can see within these areas. Thank you. Now, as I'm adding these details over the top, I'm leaving gaps in between. So I don't want to cover the entire leaf with the same colour, with this darker mix. You've got to keep looking backward and forward at that reference photograph. And to be honest with you, my eyes are going backward and forward every few seconds. So it's literally just 2-3 seconds, I'm back looking at the photograph again. I probably got a very short-term memory, but hey, I don't care. Because at least this way it does work, and it kind of helps that image stay in your mind that little bit longer just by keeping glancing backward and forward at your photograph. Now, mentioning photographs as well, because I've provided a very large version of this ivy leaf, which I photographed in our back garden, actually, believe it or not, and because of that, you can zoom in, you can pinch in to this reference photograph. So you can really look deep into those fine details that you can see there. So if you want to go even more detailed than we're going to go to today, then you have that option as well. Now, you've got to notice how it's dark around the edges of the leaf as well, but not all the edges. There are certain areas which are kind of capturing the light a bit more to show the light and show the curve. So look around the edge and you can see how it's darker in certain sections as well. So when you look, for example, around the left-hand edge where I'm working now, you've got to think about creating a round feel to it. So using the stippling and tiny dots, so very, very tiny dots, and you want these dots to gradually get further apart as you do so as well. At least that way, as it comes in towards a leaf from the edge, add fewer dots and that will give an impression of more of a curved feel as you do so. So this is where we start thinking about the shapes of both the light and the dark inside the leaf as well, because we've got this slightly darker mix. As I mentioned, we're going to be leaving gaps and places where it's a little bit lighter in between. So we're not going to cover all that lovely detail we put on to begin with, or that basic foundation detail layer. So in this case, what we've got to think about is adding those mid-tone layers, which is what basically this mix is, into those areas which is not kind of really dark, kind of in between light and dark, if you get my meaning there. So by doing so, at least that way, we're going to start to get some form of a shape within this leaf to begin with. The more deeper shape, the more rounded shape we're going to get is when we start adding that darkest layer on. And then a little bit of light layer on the top. Now when I'm adding these details on, and you're just about to reload that brush, don't. What do you mean don't? Don't reload that brush. And that's because when you're using a semi-dry brush, so just before you start to think about reloading it, go to those lightest areas, okay? So because that way you can add them finest, the really, really finest of marks into those lightest sections without it getting too blobby and too dark in colour. I think the good thing about adding these darker layers as well, these mid-tone layers in this case, is that every layer you add, the darker you're going to get, the fewer marks you'll need to make, the fewer brush strokes. Seriously, because you're going to have all that light area underneath, which you still want to show through in places, don't you? So because of that, you don't need quite as much detail over the top. So bear that in mind. So you've actually done the longest process for the first layer, as in the first longest layer detail. So now every subsequent layer we add on top of this, every darker layer we're going to add on top of this, is going to be fewer brush strokes. And that way, we're going to start to create the form and the shape that we need for this ivy leaf to make it kind of work as well, to make it a bit more kind of realistic, if you know what I mean. Well, I hope you're enjoying watching the video so far. Why don't you try and learn the way that I paint? So I'm going to show you how to use my techniques and the way I produce these very detailed wildlife paintings.
And I do this on my online school on my website. So I'm going to take you across there now and show you how all that works, okay? And give you some general idea what it's all about. Now, when you arrive at my website, click on the membership icon, then down to the tutorial dashboard. I'll show you what the main tutorial dashboard looks like to give you some general idea on how easy this is to kind of navigate. So every month you get access to a full PDF step-by-step tutorial as well, which obviously can paint using this offline, so you don't have to be online watching the videos. So you can have a look at the most recently added tutorials, as you can see the line of those there. But then just below we've got the main tutorial index, okay? So we've got the birds, animals, insects, botanical. So going on to the birds, you find we've got different levels as well. So we've got beginner, intermediate, and also advanced. Let's say the wolf. So here you can see the level of ability, which I'd recommend for this particular painting, how long the video content is. You'll also be able to download the reference photograph and of course the outline drawing, and even a little mini PDF pack as well, which contains all those items together, including a list of the colours which you're going to use for this particular painting. As you go below the video, you can see all these little links down there which are highlighted. So if you click on one of those links, let's say the mouth, alright, so just go to the area where the mouth starts to play, and it takes that timeline on the video lock straight to that section of the video, so you can play it directly from there. Oh, and don't forget as well, when you are a paid member on my website, then you finally get 25% discount for all the written PDF tutorials which I have within my shop, so another bonus as well. Now the free member section, you get three videos here, alright, so you have the robin, the bee eater, and also a cat's eye paint along, which I did live. So why don't you join as a free member and see if this is the right thing just for you.
Now when you join my website on a monthly or annual subscription, you get over 70 video tutorials. I also tend to add three new ones every single month, so it's continually growing, so that means you get access to the entire back catalogue as well.
Not forgetting our private Facebook group. Sit, relax, and paint along with me using my non-technical jargon way of painting, and with a smile or two along the way. So let's get them brushes wet and let's get started.
So fine-tune the edges using a nearly dry brush again, like I mentioned earlier on, and just using that very fine point, and only barely using two hairs and air touching that paper. At least that way around you're going to get those really fine marks. So lightly soften this down again with a clean, damp brush in places, and just using very light kind of circle motions as well, that tends to help. At least that way you're not blending too much in one go. And when you do blend this, still blend it with your size 00 brush, because at least that way around you're going to kind of over blend the painting. Because if you use a larger brush, you're covering too much area in one go, and that can actually blend it all away, and we don't want to blend all these lovely details together, do we? So go around the edge and start to really fine tune these edges now. And this way you've got to really, let's say, look at that reference photograph and look at the overall shape that you can see. We know it doesn't have to be perfect, it doesn't have to be exactly the same. It doesn't, because they're all going to be more or less different, aren't they, in some shape or form, these ivy leaves. And we find that with a lot of things we paint out in the wild, you know, from leaves to flowers to all sorts of plants, even down to the bark on a tree. So there's such a variety of different shapes and sizes out there. So don't worry too much if it's not exactly as it is on the reference photograph. So simply adjust your dark areas for those little finer touches. Right, so now we need to think about lifting off some paint. I know, we just spent all that time putting that paint on, then we're going to take it off. Yes, that's what we're going to do next. And the idea behind this is that we're going to use a lifting off technique to kind of reveal those fine lines, those fine veins we can see within this leaf. Now to do this, you want to dampen that brush first of all, so wet it really is what I tend to do. And I like to have a piece of folded kitchen roll in the palm of my hand. At least that way around, I can rag that brush very lightly through that kitchen roll, just once will do. And then that's probably just about enough water left on the brush to start using that lifting off technique. Because one thing you don't want to do is flood the paper with water. So using just a damp, clean brush, start to lift off the paper by going over the same line time and time again. Try not to deviate from that line if you can help it. Okay, and if you need to do this in very short areas, don't try and do one long line in one go, just very short areas. And you can extend that line and change the shape and the curve of that line as you go along. So keep going over the same place time and time again, and then very lightly dab it with that kitchen roll in the palm of your hand. Now every now and then rotate that kitchen roll around, so keep changing the corner of it, because you start to get quite a little build up of paint on that kitchen roll. And because of that, you'll end up transferring the paint back to the paper from the kitchen roll, basically, which is what you don't want to do. Keep washing that brush out as well. So every two or three times you try to lift paint off, give a quick rinse out, semi-dry it again, and go back to that painting to start lifting off some more details. Again, you don't have to be too precise with this, because you don't have to get it exactly the same as that reference photograph. So once you've done this little bit of lifting off work, just on this one section, go for lemon yellow and sap green to a milky consistency. And then you can add this over the top of that lifted off area, just kind of give it a bit more colour again. So just kind of, brighten it up that little bit more. So very lightly go over the top, and then just let it blend in and soften in and dry on top of that paper. Now go for sap green, Payne's grey and lamp black, and this is where you can really fine tune these veins in now, just by touching in some of the edges, not all of them though, just some of those edges, and add in extra details around the leaf as well. So every single section that you can see, you find that there's a lot of fine dark lines in there. But you want to make sure your brush is nearly dry when you do this, so you got that finest tip again. Remember about that? So make sure there's not too much paint on that brush tip. I quite like doing this part as well, because this is where you really start to kind of fine tune, as I keep going on about fine tuning, but this is where you start to add those finer details again. There's little thin veins you can see. So you got the main veins, now you want those little thin areas. So then we've got to continue and do the rest of the leaf using the same lifting off technique, adding the same color wash over the top of the veins themselves, and then add those extra little vein details in using that darkest mix. So how are you getting on? I do hope you're finding my video tutorial on how to paint a realistic ivy leaf in watercolour useful. And if you are, would you mind simply clicking on the thumbs up down below? Because YouTube will show my video to even more budding artists the more likes that I get. Thank you. Now, here we go. Watercolor white. Opaque watercolor white. Now, I like to use opaque watercolor white. Not semi-opaque, not semi-transparent. For me, it's got to be opaque. At least that way, there's a better chance it will cover up what's underneath, okay? Even though I find watercolor white is not completely opaque, but it's good enough for what I use it for. You can, however, use white gouache as well as another medium, so whichever you prefer to use. Just make sure that it mixes to a kind of creamy consistency, and don't overload that brush as well, so too much paint on the brush will make it look far too blobby on the paper. So start from the right-hand edge, and this is the area that you can see here. So very lightly tap it, just tiny, tiny taps on the paper. And the more dots you put closer together, obviously the whiter it will look, you know, it's going to be a lot whiter, isn't it? And now you'll also find with watercolour white is that it will very often dry duller. And because of that, you think, oh, it's not very bright. But when it's dry, you can then add another layer over the top if you want to. But like we did with the darkest layer, start from the edge, on those edges that need it, and then gradually get add fewer marks, should I say, as you come in towards the leaf. Look around the leaf and look for those brighter areas that you can see. Now, if it's too bright, you can tone the white down, so you can add a little bit more water into your white mix. But to do that, what I suggest you do is just steal some of that white paint from one mixing well and pop it into another one and add a little bit of water into that one. At least that way you've got both consistencies, haven't you? You've got the creamy and you've got more of a milky consistency. Now, the milky consistency version will dry paler. So that's really handy for those not quite so bright areas, but you still need a little bit of brightness to it. And that's in case, obviously, by lifting off isn't quite enough for you, so you can do it that way around as well. Add a few tiny little dots here and there around the leaf as well. And again, keep looking around for those bright areas that you can see. Right, now for the stem. So let's mix up some colours. So burnt sienna, alizarin crimson, and burnt umber. So we'll start off with a burnt sienna. I'm going to add that straight into the stem. Don't worry about wetting it, first of all. We don't need to, do we? It's a very small, tiny area. So once you've got this colour in, then we can start to add in a little bit of alizarin crimson just into places, or let it blend in there to kind of warm it up a little bit. Once that's in there, we can then add a little bit of burnt umber in as well. Kind of vary it, dot it in places. Now this is going to be fairly dark anyway, but I just want this colour to be underneath, if you know what I mean, because if we need at some point to lift any paint off, we know that this colour is still underneath, because this will be dry underneath. So when we add the darkest layers over the top of this stem, we can then, if we decide to, lift off some paint, which will then in turn reveal all these colours underneath. Thank you. Now go for the lamp black with a burnt umber this time, more to a creamy consistency. And we can use this now to get those darker mixes, those darker marks on there. So work on both sides first of all, and then we can start to fill in the inside, okay? And all we're going to do that, once you've got those darker lines on both sides, is just use a damp clean brush initially, just to soften down the inside edge of both sides. So that way we'll get more of a curved feel to the way this is going to look as well. Now use a damp clean brush just to soften that very end, just so it blends out to the white of the paper. Then simply give it a dry and then come back in with that same mix again. It's a little bit thicker, if you make it nice and thick, creamy consistency. And then you can just add those darkest edges to this area as well to give it that extra little bit of contrast. Now do leave me a comment if you found this video useful, and I would love to see your finished paintings as well. Now don't forget that the links to all the reference materials are down in the description below, and that also includes a link to some free content which you'll find on my website. I'll of course see you in my next video to my right, where we can add to our leaf painting skills and paint an autumnal bramble leaf in watercolour. I'll see you there.